Hello friends, today we will be discussing on work sampling. We will have a small introduction of the work sampling, what is work sampling, what are its benefits and how to draw a work sampling chart and other things we will be able to discuss today. At the end of this session, you will be able to understand the concept of work sampling and the procedure to carry out the same. What is work sampling? What are its principle? How to determine the sample size? What is the procedure? What are the advantages and limitations of this? We are going to discuss today one by one. Initially, we'll start with what is work sampling. Well, it is a work measurement technique in which a large number of instantaneous observations are made at random intervals over a specified period of time of workers, machines and processes. As you know, it is one of the measurement techniques. Time study and work sampling are the two predominant measurement techniques which are commonly used for finding out the time required for the job and then hence norm setting. Individually, time study has its own areas of applications and work sampling has its own different area of applications, though both can be used to find out the time required for the particular operation. The work sampling is basically a statistical technique where we have got large number of observations are to be made. And what is the principle of work sampling? This is the principle of the work sampling. Work sampling, it is a statistical technique. It is based on the theory of sampling and probability. The distribution curve followed for the work sampling is generally normal distribution having a pattern of 6 sigma. All of you know what is 6 sigma is. And then you have to think of what are the various sigma levels and try to interpret the meaning of this. What is the meaning of 1 sigma, 2 sigma, 3 sigma, plus minus 3 and plus minus 4 sigma. Each sigma will have a particular different area under the curve and it will represent a particular number that will be used henceforth for relevant calculations. We will be discussing much about these numbers and the sigma levels in the further part of this presentation. Sampling, as you know, is a basis of statistics and determination of sample size is a crucial matter in the sampling study. What is sampling? Now, for example, in the class, my class, students have got a 80% attendance as an average. If I say that 80% average, I am talking it on a sampling basis. It does not mean that the same 20% students will remain absent continuously for all my lectures. But it depends upon the overall percentage of the absenteeism and presenteeism students. And if I take number of observations and trying to find out the total percentage of students, it comes out to be 80%. 20% of the floating population by and large will remain absent for the lecture. That is what the sampling is. We also understand the sampling for election polls. We also have sampling for variety of economic surveys of the government. We also have sampling for students, their ages and their geographical studies. There are a number of statistical applications of this sampling where we are now trying to find out sampling for utilization of the machine or sampling for much utilization of equipment or manpower, and in turn we are trying to find out utilization, then time required for a particular job and how to avoid the unnecessary or delayed elements in the sampling asset. The sampling technique relies on the sample size. The sample size formula is shown over here. It is shown as x into sigma p, which is equal to x under root p into bracket 1 minus p upon n, where p is the average probability, x is the value which depends upon the desired confidence level, p is the percentage of occurrence of the activity, s is the error in the fraction and n number of observations required. As you know, sampling will have major, sampling dependency will have on the two major things. The first is the number of samples to be taken, that is sample size. The accuracy we are interested in and what is the confidence level of the particular accuracy. These things are taken together. So confidence level and the percentage error, these are the two determinants which will determine the sampling size as such. Let us come back to the procedure of the work sampling. How the procedure is, we have to first define the problem. What is the basic purpose of the problem and what is the basic purpose of the work sampling and why are we going for this. Once the problem is well defined, then we have to design a chart which is used for recording information, then make a pilot study. Pilot study with some observations, maybe 100, 200, 50, depends upon the feasibility, depends upon the further accuracy we want it and so on. Once the preliminary observations are done, then we have to calculate the exact number of observations required for the designed confidence level and for the designed accuracy level. prelim, we have to compute the delay percentage, and then we have to determine the accuracy and confidence level as desired for the investigation. Once this is decided, then we have to get these approvals from the section heads or the concerned management people. We have to explain them what is the entire procedure, and then we have to tell them what is the confidence level we are interested in, what is the accuracy. Also, workers, operators and the entire group has to be taken into confidence, and we explain them what is the purpose of this study and what we are going to achieve through this purpose. It is not a person-based technique. Generally, operators will have a resistance initially. They have got lot of myths about the particular any industrial technique as such. Work sampling, of course, is not an exception to it. We have to explain them very well what is the purpose, how you are going to study and other things. Once that is there, then we have to continue the number of observations required for the chosen confidence level. It depends upon more number of observations, more will be the accuracy. With increased number of observations, of course, cost will also increase. Number of observations are decided in the light of confidence level required. Once the observations are final completed, then we have to observations are decided, we have to select and instruct the people. We have to just give the instructions that how observations are to be taken, what determine number of days or shifts required for the study, plan the schedule of the observation such as time for taking and route to be followed by the observer, proceed with the sampling of observations in the chart, making note of any unusual points. Once the data is available, then presenting the results, the work sampling data are analyzed during the study in order to check if the things are going according to the plan or not. The data is usually summarized at the end of the each day. The activities, now after the procedure, if you understand the procedure, for example, even if you take a very simple example that there are only two machines, just to understand, I am just explaining the concept, there are two machines are there and one supervisor is there who want to study the utilization of the machine. What you will do is, he will finalize a sampling study and take random observations of the machine and then calculate the total percentage of the observations of working and non-working to the total number of observations, and that will give the proper utilization. What are the advantages of this? The activities which are impractical or costly to measure can be measured readily by work sampling. A single observer can make all the study as compared to that required for a continuous time study. The cost and time involved in the work sampling study is quite less as compared to other data, other techniques. Work sampling study may be interpreted at any time without affecting the results. There is less chance of obtaining misleading results as the operators are not under close observation. Work sampling studies are less tedious and cause less fatigue to the observer. It is not necessary to use trained time study observer. Time study is a very, very skilled job. Time study requires lot of training to the time study engineer. You have to have lot of issues in the time study, and only trained time study people can take it. Whereas work sampling just is only take random observations at a given moment and mark in the appropriate column whether it is working, non-working or delay and what is the reason for delay. It is just a typical job which you have to follow the instructions. Once that is there, and stopwatch or other time devices are not required for work sampling. The only major thing is it requires the random sampling, and the random numbers are generated using by random number tables or calculator or computers nowadays. We can use random numbers and then we have to follow the random numbers, take the observations. Well, there are some limitations of this study. The limitations are, it does not permit finer breakdown of the activities and delays. It cannot provide a detailed information. It is economical when a large number of operators are observed for studying operators or machines located over wide areas. In certain kind of work sampling studies, the record of method used by the operator is not made. Therefore, whenever a method change occurs, any element in the entire new study must be made. It is not a record specific. We are not recording any method during the work sampling as such. Management or workers may not understand statistical work sampling as they do time study. Time study, though it is difficult to conduct, analyze, but it is that way easily understood by the workers as well as the management. But whereas work sampling being a statistical one, they may feel that it involves a lot of statistical jargons. As a result of that, it is slightly difficult to make them convince to the workers and management that what are the various applications, what are the various analysis and conclusions of the work sampling, and what are the advantages of it. So there are some natural limitations of this work sampling as such. So in summary, we have studied today what is work sampling, what are its applications, and how to go about work sampling, what are the procedure, what is step by step element, and how to follow the work sampling process. Well, let us try with this procedure, and you can try one actual work sampling study under your observations by visiting to nearby A industry. Thank you.